In this module, we'll summarize the information presented in this training and discuss some take-home messages. Over separate modules in this training, we touched on radiation epidemiology and its contributions to our understanding of health effects, on the strengths and limitations of selected radiation studies, and on how you should be cautious in interpreting results from such studies. We live in a world where radiation exposures to all of us are increasing, in medicine, in the environment, in certain occupations, in travel, and in the development of nuclear technologies. There is concern about radiological accidents and intentional acts. In whatever area or circumstance you can think of, we have more and more exposures to radiation. So radiation epidemiology is needed. It was needed in the past, and it is the foundation for creating radiation protection standards and guidance needed by regulators, decision makers, and managers. Radiation epidemiology also is needed now and certainly in the future as the issues facing the nation are becoming more complex. There is a focus on conducting studies of large populations exposed to low doses at low rates, the type of exposure we are concerned about in our daily lives and occupations. There are continuing needs to inform regulators, decision makers, and managers on the latest understandings of radiation risks associated with changing circumstances. This need was emphasized in recent Government Accountability Office, or GAO, reports on radiation research. Is there enough human capital to meet those needs? Are there enough radiation professionals? This is an area of concern for the National Council on Radiation Protection and Measurements, as well as many radiation agencies and industries. Another take-home message is that all studies have limitations, and some are more limited than others, even if published in high-visibility journals. Some studies are useful and reliable, and others are not and should be discounted in decision-making. Hopefully, I've provided some basic understanding of what to look for to separate the wheat from the chaff, the good from the flawed, the reliable from the unreliable. So what is helpful to distinguish the reliable from the unreliable? The study must have sound epidemiologic methods, procedures to design, conduct, and analyze the study properly. You should consider whether the population is well-defined, whether the information on radiation dose and outcome, such as cancer occurrence, is comparable between exposed and unexposed, whether one group received special screening that the others didn't, whether the follow-up and outcome ascertainment was complete and comparable between the exposed and non-exposed, whether the study size was adequate to detect an effect had there been one, whether the likelihood of serious biases, such as selection bias or information bias, was high, whether serious confounding influences, such as cigarette smoking, were accounted for or addressed, whether the dosimetry, that is, the estimates of radiation doses, were of highest quality. Was there any dosimetry? Were doses estimated for individuals? Many studies can be discounted solely because of unreliable dosimetry. You've also got to have comprehensive statistical analyses. When you're dealing with low doses, the choice of parameters that you put into your statistical models can make the difference on whether your study is statistically significant. Statistical significance is probably overplayed. It does not mean that a result is causal or not. It suggests that the play of chance might be reduced somewhat as a possible explanation for the findings. But statistically significant results can be totally biased and wrong. The analysis should be transparent to understand what was done, and not just a phrase, "we used logistic regression." Are the results consistent with other reliable studies, or are they inconsistent? If the study is the only one in the world that reports enormously high or enormously low risk, this suggests the likely possibilities of serious errors. Were the results biologically plausible? For example, is it plausible that a CT exam of the abdomen would cause a brain tumor? Is it biologically plausible that radiation in a single study would increase the risk of all individual cancers and by the same amount, even for cancers not known to be increased following radiation? Having a dose gradient helps in making causal interpretations. Did the conclusion hang on subgroup analyses, sort of like cherry picking to emphasize the result the authors appeared to have wanted? Is the paper balanced or just one-sided, discounting limitations or contradictory information? And be aware that in the radiation arena, there is a group who believe that radiation at low doses is good for you. They are proponents of radiation hormesis. They claim that there is evidence for a threshold below which there are no radiation effects, or the effects are good ones. They are against using the linear non-threshold dose response model for the purposes of radiation protection. On the opposite end of the spectrum, there is another group who believe that radiation exposure is bad. Even a single radioactive molecule or a single gamma ray. This group believes that all sources of radiation exposure should be eliminated. A related problem is the abuse of the concept of collective dose as used in radiation protection. Collective dose is when the estimates of individual doses in a population are summed. This might be done to consider whether cost-effective actions could be taken to reduce this collective dose. Misuse occurs when the collective dose is used to predict numbers of cancer deaths attributable to minuscule population exposures. Radiation protection organizations, regulators, and managers need to have the latest and best epidemiologic findings to make informed judgments and decisions. Much of the study evaluations are just common sense. If results seem peculiar or wrong, they probably are, and careful scrutiny is called for. There's not a simple checklist that separates the reliable from the unreliable studies, but there are multiple and diverse topics to focus on before coming to your own conclusion on whether a study is trustworthy or not. Be skeptical. There's a lot of unreliable and flawed studies out there, and you should be aware of that. This review that I've provided is not totally original, except for my interpretation, but based on the world's literature. We have radiation reports that review epidemiologic studies published periodically from the United Nations, the National Academy of Sciences, and from international and national protection and scientific committees. It's rather remarkable, I think, that we have standing committees in the United States and throughout the world that periodically review the effects of ionizing radiation. The National Academy has a series of reports dedicated to the biological effects of ionizing radiation. At the National Council on Radiation Protection, there is a continual review of the literature on radiation epidemiology and biology. A 2018 NCRP commentary reviews the quality of all recent epidemiologic studies considering methods, dosimetry, and statistics. The World Health Organization has several volumes reviewing the radiation literature. No other carcinogen, not even tobacco, has such an array of ongoing committees continually assessing health effects. Radiation is unique, and because of population exposures and population concerns, deserves, in my view, this continued attention. Thank you very much for this opportunity to talk about my profession.